In this episode of the Petronas Retro Race Review, we're looking back at the 2015 US Grand Prix. The drivers had to deal with difficult weather conditions, virtual safety cars and safety cars, but the team managed to secure a 1-2 finish and Lewis won his third Drivers' Championship. James, how do you approach a weekend like this when the weather conditions are so changeable?
First time we've had really difficult conditions in Austin. Frequently when we go there, there's a big temperature change. Ignoring the rain for now, but you can turn up there and be 25, 30 degrees almost, and the next day it's 2 degrees in the morning and barely gets above 12 or into double digits. So around the time that we go to Austin, it's just about the time where it becomes very, very cool there. And the second element is the rain that obviously appeared in this 2015 race and really affected the whole weekend. In terms of how we prepare for it, the cars these days, you don't really set them up like in 10, 20 years ago, where you raise the ride heights and do a number of other changes in order to optimize for the rain conditions. The car we have is a car that should work fairly well on the intermediates, the X-wets, and the dry tires. But we are allowed to use something called change of climatic. Change of climatic, for example, would be if we had a dry qualifying session, but a wet race. The FI would allow us to change brake ducts and cooling in order to accommodate the complete change in conditions from what we had from one session to the next. Now, of course, the inverse here, we had fundamentally a wet qualifying and predominantly a dry race. And as a result of that, the car is able to be adjusted between both of those sessions. Now, whilst it's only catens, which is the area, the carbon area that we call inside the wheel, effectively. So the wheel comes off, you'll see that that's just shrouded in carbon. That's what we call a catin because it looks a little bit like a catin that you used to be able to buy here in England. You're allowed to change that, and that has quite a powerful effect on pressures and temperatures and allows you, for example, to get an intermediate tire working much, much quicker. Or perhaps if you need warm-up, you can warm up tires a little bit better in terms of the dry compounds. But those also have negatives that are attached to them as well. If it's a dry race that then warms up, you could be in completely the wrong tire operating window. You're also allowed to change cooling. So it is entirely possible that you end up with a closed up bodywork for a wet qualifying session and then open it back up for the race again to optimize both sessions. In terms of what we do with the car, we don't run the car in the wind tunnel with intermediate tires or X-wet tires on. They're run with dry tires on. So everything that you optimize aerodynamically is around one tire shape. But cars obviously have to run intermediates and X-wet tires. And what the tires do is they're a little bit wider, a little bit bigger, and they lift the car up slightly. And the result of that is that you can end up with the car operating in a slightly different window to where it operated previously. And it's not uncommon to see different cars working better on the intermediate, perhaps better on the X-wet, or again, better on the dry tire if you've had a race with all three compounds. It's really not uncommon. And again, in this year, at this Grand Prix, you would have seen that change between what happened in qualifying, what happened on the first intermittent, and again, what happened throughout the course of the race. It's really difficult to build a car that works really well in all three conditions, all three tires. It's just not that possible. But equally, as mentioned, it's not like we dedicate hours of work to really getting the car optimized in those regions. Here, in this case, we did have quite a bit of running on Friday on the intermediate tire and the X-wet tire. So we were able to understand a little bit around the car, but we didn't change the car dramatically. In fact, you have to fall back to your simulation, what you go into the event with to a certain extent, in order to make sure you optimize your package.
The weather conditions had such a huge effect on the entire race weekend, so much so that we had qualifying taking place on the Sunday before the race. And that brings me to the first question we've had in from Dan on Instagram, asking how challenging it was for the team to have qualifying before the race, all on one day.
It changes things dramatically. So to give you an idea, for both the drivers and the team, qualifying doesn't feel like an hour to us. It feels around about like 10 minutes is the best way I can explain it. Everything is much, much faster and happens very, very quickly. You're filled with adrenaline, that's normal, the drivers are, we are as well. You're performing at what we would consider a peak level. So everything we do across almost the week, so in some cases we turn up several days earlier, we get our hours sorted, we get our working rhythm sorted, such that by the time it comes to 1 hour in qualifying and a couple of hours in the race, we should be performing at our absolute peak. The result of that is that when you have a qualifying that's either extended, delayed, or even moved to the following day, you have these huge roller coasters of emotions and adrenaline as well at the same time that you need to just work to and control. And instead of perhaps being optimized for an hour, in the case of a 4 hour extended qualifying sessions, you need to make sure that you're back on point the second you restart. qualifying is for me anyway, as exhilarating as the race. In qualifying, one decision you make, be it on not stopping for another set of tyres, not being on the right compound, not doing the right runs, can put you between a car that can be on pole to back in out in Q1, so 16th, 17th on the grid. And you've seen that happen with top teams several times over the last few years. So it's not a one-off. It happens. It happens because you're playing with probabilities and trying to manage them. So to go into a qualifying session, you need to have a whole series of decisions, and everyone has to be very aligned on what you're doing. Pit crew, drivers, engineers. And that takes a lot of practice. And as soon as you have a qualifying session that's both wet, so now everything's very dynamic to what you're used to, and also one that's extended, delayed, red flagged, and then moved, really the rules of that whole game change as a result. And you have to adapt to it. And that's what we as a team really thought about even before we got to Saturday. So Ron Meadows, our sporting director, and us as a team, the engineering team, all got together and discussed the what ifs. By the time we got through Friday, it became fairly clear that Saturday was also going to be affected by rain, but Sunday looked pretty good weather conditions. The result of that was we were already thinking in advance of what ifs. What if qualifying is delayed? What if qualifying moves to Sunday morning? What if there is no qualifying session whatsoever at all? And we cover those off in different ways. For example, the grid could be formed from the time that you set in Friday or the time that you set in the free practice session on Saturday morning. So part of our goal in those sessions was to make sure that we were at the top of the leaderboards just in case qualifying didn't happen as the result. So just really trying to show the knock-on effects of having to really think through the weekend and expect these sort of conditions. In terms of qualifying itself, moving to Sunday morning, the biggest problem is that you very much compress the whole weekend together. So normally, my team of strategists and our engineers would have a whole evening on Saturday to go through what's happening in qualifying, understand where we want to be, understand what we want to prepare for the following day. And it's very difficult to do that strategic work until you know where you are on the grid and how we performed relative to our competition. That work now gets compressed into a matter of hours at best on a Sunday morning. And it just means you go into the race less prepared. Combined with that, we had no data from Friday to work with on the dry tyres whatsoever at all. So that includes both from a setup perspective and a strategic perspective, which means to a certain extent we're reliant on what we estimated or used our models to predict before going into the weekend. So again, a lot of the work that we're doing on Sunday morning is what ifs. What if we're wrong? How do we deal with it here, here and here? How do we expect to perform in these conditions? And just really planning that out before we go into the race.
So did you have a race planner like you would normally?
We did, but it's based on very much really a build-up of the last four or five races in terms of understanding how the tyres would perform and how the cars would perform. So yeah, if normally go into a race with a good amount of certainty, let's say, of where we'll be fighting, what will be going on pit stop-wise here in the USA Grand Prix, we didn't have that knowledge. So you really have to be a lot more flexible with what you're providing the drivers, because the facts are we don't have all the facts this time. I mean, it's a poor expression, but you get the idea. And that dynamic reaction that we're asking them to come up with and that we'll be doing in the background at the same time is what will allow you to overcome these problems that you face in these mixed condition races.
So we eventually got to the race. And of course, there was that moment between Nico and Lewis. And we've had a question in from John on Twitter saying, was there any damage when the cars touched going around turn one?
No, there was no damage. I mean, often you are right, there would be damage perhaps around the floor areas, typically what you would see in there. This was very much wheel-to-wheel contact. I mean, the big effect was obviously Nico went all the way back to fifth place and then had to fight his way back through again on intermediate tyres in tricky conditions. Lewis just carried too much speed into turn one. That's the reality behind it, and washed out wide. And Nico was just an innocent bystander that got pushed out as a result of it. We as a team have a strong ethos that we are here to win as a team. So when one of our drivers gets pushed back enormously as a result of the other one, we do have to review the situation correctly with both drivers and understand what happened and how do we mitigate that in the future. But let's be completely clear about it. You've got the drivers piling into a turn one on a tyre and a condition that they haven't run in that way before. So everything is a little bit unknown. And you don't know where to brake. You don't know where your brake marker should be. Should it be here, 5 metres later, 5 metres earlier? And you certainly don't know what apex speed you can carry in. So this sort of dynamic condition was somewhat expected.
Nico and Lewis also had to deal with the charging Red Bulls, Daniel Ricciardo and Daniel Kvyat. And Harry's been in touch on Twitter saying, did you expect the Red Bulls to be such a threat in the early stages of the race? And did you expect them to then maintain that pace even when it turned dry?
In the early stages of the race, the Red Bull looked like the car to beat. In fact, at one point, it was several seconds up the road before the first pit stops and pulling away from us at over a second a lap. It looked like it was going to be a very difficult race for us. And I'm pretty sure they sat there thinking, this will be all right, we'll fit the dry tyres, we might be a few tenths slower, but we're going to be okay. So to answer the question, we went in there expecting the Red Bull was a strong car at the time there. We went in there expecting that we wouldn't be necessarily the fastest car. Again, we hadn't optimised the car setup, nor had anyone. And on the inter tyre, you don't truly know where the performance is going to be. What was a surprise, though, is when the Red Bulls went to the dry tyre, they were a couple of seconds a lap slower than us. Now, you expect variability between those conditions of a few tenths, but actually, in reality, the performance swing was much, much larger than that, and we didn't expect that, and I suspect they didn't either. That year, we weren't the best on tyre degradation performance. Red Bull were better than us. They had better long runs. And at the end of that interstint, what you really saw was not just pure car pace, but also they kept the tyres in a much better condition than both Nico and Lewis. And in fact, Lewis was probably the worst of those three. So Red Bull really outperforming Lewis, Nico doing a better job than Lewis. That's why Lewis, when he came in on that lap, Nico wasn't that far behind, despite staying out again one further lap. And those sort of mixture of how you've used your intermediate tyres is a function, really, of driving style, of how you've set the car up and how the car's really working in those conditions. When they went to the dry tyres, everyone now, we looked incredibly quick relative to the competition. And you saw that Lewis really fought back up through and Nico caught back up to the Red Bulls very, very quickly. As I said, several seconds a lap. And those aren't swings that you would normally see whatsoever at all, sort of indicating perhaps a little bit more that Red Bull were in just a sweet spot on that inter tyre, but completely the wrong temperature range on the dry tyres. To get several seconds a swing, that's not aerodynamic performance between top teams. That's really fundamentally tyres not being in the right window.
We saw virtual safety cars and safety cars throughout the race. Just how difficult is it to know whether to bring your drivers in at that point?
All the work doesn't happen the second the VSC or safety car comes out. It's really talked about as much in advance as we can, which is normally several laps. More than that, you have an uncertainty of already known of going on what's going to happen in the future. With each of the safety cars and VSCs throughout these races, to a certain extent, so we had one VSC right at the beginning when no one reacted to it. So if we cover that off first of all, over the first few laps of the race, we're talking continuously on the pit wall saying, do we think it's ready for dry tyres? And when you're in that condition, so it was intermediate con tyres, at the beginning of the race, the only decision you can make is, do we want to take another set of intermediate tyres or do we think it's ready to cross over into a dry tyre condition? And that we're talking about all the time. Every lap, once a lap, we're just talking through going, do we think it's ready for dries if we had a VSC or safety car, which means probably from now in 2 to 3 laps time restarting. And you go through that loop. And at one point it goes into a maybe loop. And you talk to the drivers and you go through the same questions with the drivers. They're out there experiencing it and they can feed back to you. But on those opening laps, it was very clearly intermediate conditions. And more so, stopping on lap 4, for example, and fitting another intermediate is actually a worse overall result because you're now not just dropping positions, but you're also on new intermediate tyres on a drying track. And that can actually be disastrous at certain points, depending on the track, depending on the weather conditions. So the decision there is you're not reacting to a VSC as it comes out, you really are talking it through. When you started to get more towards the lap 10, lap 11 region, you're now in a region where possibly, if there was a safety car, you're going to have to take a punt and fit the dry tyres to the car. Because if you don't, and other people do, yeah, you're going to slide around for a few laps, but you could be in strong risk of a second safety car, you being right at the back of the pack now on dry tyres and everyone else being in front of you. So that's the region where you do have to start to react in these sort of mixed weather conditions. So that conversation is taking place continually. And that sort of VSC and safety car is, in the early stages, quite easy because you can talk it through. As you start to get towards the unknown of maybe these dry tyres can work, you're a little bit more reactive. Still, you don't make a decision in 1 second, typically. You make a decision over the space of 30 seconds to a minute, looking at conditions, who else is coming in, what tyres can you see, what other conditions are coming your way, what's the weather forecast. But it becomes a bit more dynamic. later safety cars in the race and later VSCs in the race, in a dry race, you know a lot more now. So, for example, here we had a safety car coming around in the middle of the race. By now, we've had a lot of running on the dry tyres. And again, you don't have to react to that safety car immediately. You just have to understand what the impact of that safety car is on everyone's strategy and how they react as the result of it, and therefore what we want to do. And that discussion takes place several laps prior to that safety car coming out. So we had a good idea. Everyone was forewarned on what the plan is. More so, in fact, you would have heard on the radio from time to time, we let the drivers know that they're in their safety car window or VSC window. So to explain that one, the safety cars can come out with very little warning. Perhaps even you don't even have video footage of what's happened. The safety car's been deployed. The radio has latency on it, delay on it. So if you talk to the driver over the radio, you can expect a second and a half worth of delay approximately whilst it handshakes, gets a link, and then allows the communication through. If the driver is just on his way up to the pit entry, the safety car comes out, they get a notification on their dash, and indeed all the light boards around the track let them know. And if they know they're in their safety car window, they will come into the pit lane by themselves without us guiding them. Now, of course, we'll come on the radio immediately and go box, 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 let them know that they should be coming to the pit lane. But the reason why they know they're in their safety car window is that they can react without us. It could be that the radio's gone down. It could be that they have to react very quickly to a condition. So you don't do that immediately on the spot. Obviously, that's something you put in place several laps prior and talk to the drivers before the race to let them know approximately in the race where we'd be expecting this to happen. And we have used that a few times, but only a few times have we had to ever use that. Normally, you have at least 5-6 seconds to be able to talk to the driver. So most safety cars are predictable to a certain extent. That doesn't mean we know necessarily what the right thing to do is, because a decision on the safety car is dependent on what both your competitors do, but also what happens in the future, which we'll talk about in this race specifically, because there's several impacts of that. There's another type of safety car, which is when either one of our cars has caused it, or a car that is very critical to our decision process is one of the cars that has stopped on track. Now, everything has to be a lot more reactive as the result of that. Perhaps it could have been a car that was just inside your window behind, so when you're going to stop, you're going to be right on top of them. That is the car that's just stopped on track. So now the situation's changed quite dynamically. And in those circumstances, you may have to be more reactive, so your decision could be within a few seconds rather than this process we put in several laps prior. So for example, it could have been we'd instructed the driver to not be in the safety car window. An incident happens behind where the car that we're interested in has just dropped out. Now we quickly get onto them and let them know that you're stopping this lap. In this race, any one decision you made on the safety car was affected by further safety cars in the future. So in the case of the VSC, for example, that came out later in the race, around about lap 37, at that point, we stopped Nico. Nico was the lead car of our two, and under a VSC, because the pack doesn't close back up again, if we were to bring both cars in, they would have stacked in the pit lane and you would have lost a lot of time with Lewis. In fact, it would have just meant that the gains under the VSC would have been very minimal. But as Nico came out of that stop, it looked like that was the winning strategy overall. He was now in a situation where he was on fresh tyres. Lewis was going to struggle into race on his soft tyres, and Nico was catching it at a hugely fast rate. Then we had the second safety car. And that changed the condition again. Now Nico's position of strength suddenly went to one of weakness. We stopped Lewis. Lewis came back out behind Nico on 5-lap fresher tyres. And when it restarted, Lewis was right behind him, pushing him for the remainder of the race. Now, ultimately, Nico made a mistake and went off, and that's what gave the win to Lewis. But even before then, you can see that the swing of what was the best thing to do was dependent on what happened in the future, which you don't know at the time. And that's how safety cars really completely changed the dynamics of the race, and it's what makes it interesting for us.
You mentioned a mistake made by Nico, and Lara has asked on Instagram, what was the reason for the mistake? Was it a mechanical problem, or was it just simply a mistake?
It was a mistake. The car was mechanically sound. When you're in a Formula One car and there is a gust of wind, especially a crosswind condition, the car feels to the driver potentially like it's sliding or snapping at the rear or has understeer. To explain that, I'm sure hopefully some of you have experienced being on the motorway in your road car and all of a sudden the cars move laterally across the motorway by half a meter or so, and you can feel the wind definitely when it's gusting. That's a two-ton car and it doesn't have any wings fitted to it, so it's not reliant on wings to generate downforce. So the feeling the Formula One driver has is many multiples more than what you would feel. They're literally cornering, they're loading up the front tyres, they've approached the corner exactly the same way that they would have done on the previous lap, but all of a sudden there's effectively a movement within the car as the load varies from the wind pushing on the car and then not anymore. And that's what happened to Nico. It was a mistake. He was right on the limit, as you can tell. He had to be, because Lewis was right up behind him pushing him, and as a result of it just carried more speed in, wasn't sure whether the car was about to snap round or not, and ultimately made a mistake.
If he hadn't made that mistake, would Lewis still have been able to pass him and take the win?
Lewis, whilst at the beginning of the race on the intermediate tyres, when his tyres were very warm, was really struggling, and Nico was definitely the stronger of the two there. On the dry tyres, on the soft tyre, Lewis was the stronger of the two. You can see even prior to the VSC that Lewis was very much pushing Nico right up behind him, really close, ready to overtake and pounce, but not quite able to do so. Now, at the end of the race, you've got Lewis on five lap younger tyres, and more so, Nico, after his VSC stop, was pushing very, very hard. So Nico's tyres were not just five laps older, but quite worn as well as a result of the amount that he was pushing to catch back up. And the reality behind it is that there was around about half a second of delta between them from our calculations. Now, that's not quite enough to pass as a nailed-on definite overtake around Austin, but it'll definitely put you in contention for lining up a pass several times over. It would have been close. I really couldn't predict which way it would have been, but I think you would have seen a strong fight, irrespective of this mistake, right to the flag.
Well, it was a fabulous race back then in 2015. It was great to watch it back again recently and to discuss it with you, James. Thank you so much.
Thank you.
Okay. In this episode of the Petronas Retro Race Review, what is the matter now?
I opened the clapper thing and I made myself laugh.